Dr. Anne Skomorowski, Assistant Professor, Columbia University Medical Center, New York. The topic is Mood and Anxiety in Fragile X Pre-Mutation Carriers.
Additional things that they mentioned is the long 5% of the families spent 10 or more visits with clinicians before the diagnosis could be made. The mothers retrospectively cited the missed opportunities for early intervention that this delay caused and how deeply they regretted that. And in addition, 25 to 40% of these mothers had already had another child during the interval between their first detection of issues and the diagnosis being made. Other burdens include lost economic opportunities for the family, the medical and educational costs that they face, and the stigma and social isolation associated with being a mother of a child with a genetic intellectual disability. These mothers also face significant health concerns, as Stephanie was discussing, and I want to emphasize here that every one of these health concerns is associated with psychiatric symptoms. The fragile X tremor ataxia syndrome, ovarian insufficiency, menopause being a time of great vulnerability for women to develop depression and anxiety. Thyroid disease, both hyper and hypothyroidism, are associated with psychiatric disturbance. Chronic pain, fibromyalgia, and sleep disorders. Women who are caring for adults, usually a parent with FXSAS, face all the struggles that any person faces in caring with a demented elder person, including impulsivity, outbursts, delusions, which may involve the caregiver and be very disturbing for the family. And also, since many grandparents are extremely helpful in raising children with fragile X syndrome, the loss of that support, both economic and emotional, when the grandparent becomes ill and can no longer help. I want to acknowledge protective factors in the fragile X community and fragile X families, which is that after receiving a diagnosis, the family may receive increased support. Some women and their families benefit from a reassessment of their values after discovering that a child has a significant disability, realizing that things that they thought were important are not as important as they used to think, finding some inner strength and hope in coping with these difficulties. For mothers, increased help seeking. Some women are willing to go out on a limb for their children in a way that they would not do for themselves. So looking out for the child actually has the benefit of helping them with their own condition. And as a result of that, women who are mothers of fragile X children may be more likely to be prescribed psychotropic medications to treat their emotional disturbance. What I want to get to right now is that the number one risk factor for depression, the number one genetic risk factor for depression, is not the fragile X mutation. It's being a woman. Women have a much higher risk of mental disorders than men do, and depression is particularly common in women. Unipolar depression is on its way to becoming the largest burden of global disability on the planet, and it's twice as common in women. And in addition, women may have more severe depression and more recurrent depression than men do. So, reviewing what is depression. Depression is a syndrome, meaning it's a collection of symptoms. Here we have 9 symptoms that in our DSM-5 we associate with depression. And basically these are feeling depressed, losing interest and pleasure in activities, changes in appetite and sleep, loss of energy, feeling worthless, hopeless, having difficulty concentrating, thinking of death or even suicide. Some people may not articulate these symptoms, but rather will have more non-specific symptoms like aches and pains, fatigue, and sleep difficulties. So how do you diagnose depression if you're a busy pediatrician with a hyperactive child in your office? The PHQ-9, Patient Health Questionnaire 9, is a well-validated instrument that's used in primary care clinics. It has 9 domains, each corresponding to one of that list of 9 symptoms that I mentioned earlier. It's a self-rating instrument, so it can be handed to a mother in the waiting room. She can circle the number that corresponds to her situation, and then that's something that can be discussed later in the visit. And this is how you score the PHQ-9. the important thing is that a score of over 14 on the PHQ-9 suggests that this is a woman who needs further evaluation and referral to a mental health professional. If 9 questions is too many, we have the PHQ-2. And I'm not going to the PHQ, excuse me. There we go, the PHQ-2. So the PHQ-2 has only 2 questions. Decreased interest in pleasure and feeling depressed. And as you can see at the bottom of the slide, more than 1 or 2 positive answers to that question is highly predictive of having a significant mental disorder. And the number one question screening tool for depression in women, and in fact in all people, is, are you depressed? Most people know what that means, and there was, excuse me, having a little trouble with this button. Okay. So this study of adults with multiple sclerosis showed that there was a 91% sensitivity of asking adults, are you depressed, in identifying depression. And I think, are you depressed, is something that can come up in the course of evaluation of a child, can be extremely productive and helpful for the mother to just bring that out into the open. So quickly, what is anxiety? In my experience, anxiety and depression have so much overlap that there may not even be any point in distinguishing between them. But essentially, anxiety involves many of the same symptoms as depression, with an emphasis on muscle tension, irritability, and restlessness. A panic attack is an experience of anxiety that's very sudden, often unprovoked, and extremely severe, and people describe it as a crescendo in which the person goes from no anxiety to 10 out of 10 anxiety within the course of about a minute. That can last just a few minutes, but the experience of a panic attack is so aversive that the sufferer will then begin to avoid triggers that he or she believes started the panic attack. So if somebody has a panic attack, let's say on a bus, they may never want to take a bus again, and gradually they develop agoraphobia, where they're afraid at times even to leave their home. Social anxiety is extremely common in pre-mutation carriers, and essentially just another form of anxiety with an emphasis on a lot of anticipatory anxiety about being around people, feeling that people will judge them or dislike them, feeling that they may be humiliated, and having some physiologic symptoms of that anxiety, feeling nauseated, trembling, sweating. So as a psychiatrist, I always feel a need to talk about suicide with patients. And I put this slide here because I want to emphasize 2 myths that are common about suicide that I think it's important to debunk. The first is, some people think that asking about suicidal thoughts or plans might precipitate suicide or might be destructive to the patient. And that is not true. Asking a patient if they're having suicidal thoughts does not cause a patient to become suicidal. And in fact, it may prevent suicide by bringing such severe emotional distress out into the open and decreasing shame around those thoughts. Most people who are having suicidal thoughts are very ashamed of them and don't want to tell anybody unless you ask. The other concern is that some patients think that antidepressants will cause them to become suicidal. And this has been, of course, a big concern for psychiatrists since this idea first got off the ground maybe 10 years ago. And there have been lots of meta-analyses looking at whether antidepressants actually do cause suicidal behavior. Almost all have concluded that antidepressants do not increase suicide rates and, in fact, dramatically decrease them. However, it's fair to acknowledge that there are some situations in which the activation caused by starting an antidepressant may contribute to suicidal behavior. So patients who are depressed, particularly patients who are suicidal, should be started on antidepressants, but they require monitoring, especially in the first few weeks. So what can anybody do when confronted with a patient with depression? Particularly, I'm imagining the scenario that a mother is in the office with her child. is probably the most important thing that you can do, just allowing a mother to speak of her difficulties and encouraging her to know that it's acceptable to be struggling and that it's acceptable to talk about her own emotional distress. Caregiver relief and kids' behavior is probably the most important point that I'd like to underline. Thinking back on those highlighted in red slides that I had earlier, the most difficult thing for mothers of kids with developmental disabilities is dealing with their child's disruptive behaviors. And anything that you can do as pediatricians to help with children's behavior difficulties will be immense relief for the mother. And you've got to inquire about what are the most difficult behaviors for the mother to handle. She may not come forward and say, my child abuses me, my child kicks me or pinches me. You have to actually ask, or mothers will be ashamed, will protect their child, will feel that it's not acceptable to speak of these things. So my conclusion is that mental disorders are extremely common in all people, particularly women, and in this scenario, particularly women who are raising developmentally disabled children who have behavioral difficulties. And I'd like to thank everybody for listening and for giving me the honor of being able to speak to you here in India. Thank you so much. If anyone has questions, I'm